ಓಂ ನಮಃ ಪರಮಋಷಿಭ್ಯೋ ನಮಃ ಪರಮಋಷಿಭ್ಯಾಂ ಹರಿಹಿ ಓಂ. ಅಂತರಾಯತ ವಿರೂಪ ಶಾಂತಯೇ ಶಾಂತ ಪಾವನಮಚಂತ್ಯ ವೈಭವಂ ತಂ ನರಂ ವಪುಷಿ ಕುಂಜರಂ ಮುಖೇ ಮನ್ಮಹೇ ಕಿಮಪಿ ತುಂದಿಲಂ ಮಹಃ. ಗುರುರ್ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಗುರುರ್ವಿಷ್ಣು ಗುರುರ್ದೇವೋ ಮಹೇಶ್ವರ ಗುರುಸಾಕ್ಷಾತ್ ಪರಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. ಈಶ್ವರೋ ಗುರುರಾತ್ಮೇತಿ ಮೂರ್ತಿಭೇದ ವಿಭಾಗಿನಿ ವ್ಯೋಮವದ್ವ್ಯಾಪ್ತದೇಹಾಯ ದಕ್ಷಿಣಾಮೂರ್ತಯೇ ನಮಃ. ಯಸ್ಯಾಂತನ್ನಾದಿಮಧ್ಯಂ ನಹಿ ಕರಚರಣಂ ನಾಮಗೋತ್ರಂ ನ ಸೂತ್ರಂ ನೋ ಜಾತಿರ್ನೈವ ವರ್ಣಾ ನ ಭವತಿ ಪುರುಷೋ ನಾನಪುಂಸಂ ನ ಚ ಸ್ತ್ರೀ ನಾಕಾರಂ ನೋ ವಿಕಾರಂ ನಹಿ ಜನಿಮರಣಂ ನಾಸ್ತಿ ಪುಣ್ಯಂ ನ ಪಾಪಂ ತತ್ವಂ ನೋ ತತ್ವಮೇಕಂ ಸಹಜ ಸಮರಸಂ ಸದ್ಗುರುಂ ತಂ ನಮಾಮಿ. ಸದಾಶಿವಸಮಾರಂಭಾಂ ಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯಮಧ್ಯಮಾಂ ಅಸ್ಮದಾಚಾರ್ಯಪರ್ಯಂತಾಂ ವಂದೇ ಗುರುಪರಂಪರಾಂ. ಮೌನವ್ಯಾಖ್ಯಾ ಪ್ರಕಟಿತ ಪರಬ್ರಹ್ಮತತ್ವಂ ಯುವಾನಂ ವರಿಷ್ಠಾಂತೇವ ಸದೃಶಗಣೈರಾವೃತಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮನಿಷ್ಠೈಃ ಆಚಾರ್ಯೇಂದ್ರಂ ಕರಕಲಿತಚಿನ್ಮುದ್ರಮಾನಂದಮೂರ್ತಿಂ ಸ್ವಾತ್ಮಾರಾಮಂ ಉದಿತವದನಂ ದಕ್ಷಿಣಾಮೂರ್ತಿಮೀಡೇ ವೇದಾಂತಾರ್ಥವಿಭಾಸಕಾಯೇತಯೇ ಶಾಂತಾಯ ಸನ್ಯಾಸಿನೇ ನಾನಾವಾದಿನಗೇಂದ್ರಸಂಘಭವಯೇ ಯೋಗೀಂದ್ರವಂದ್ಯಾಯ ಚ ಮೋಹಧ್ವಾಂತದಿವಾಕರಾಯ ಭಗವತ್ಪಾದಾಭಿಧಾಂ ಬಿಭ್ರತೆ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಭಾಷ್ಯಕೃತೇ ನಮೋಸ್ತು ಸತತಂ ಪೂರ್ಣಾಯ ಬೋಧಾತ್ಮನೆ ಅಪಾರ ಸಚ್ಚಿತ್ಸುಖವಾರಿರಾಶೇ ಯಸ್ಯೋರ್ಮಿ ಮಾತ್ರಂ ಭುವನಂ ಸಮಸ್ತಂ ಗುಹಾಹಿತಂ ತಂ ರಮಣಂ ಗಭೀರಂ ಚಿಂತಾವಿಹೀನಂ ಹೃದಿ ಚಿಂತಯಾಮಿ. ದೇಹಂ ಮೃಣ್ಮಯವಜ್ಜಡಾತ್ಮಕಮಹಂ ಬುದ್ಧಿರ್ನ ತಸ್ಯಾಸ್ತ್ಯತೋ ನಾಹಂ ತತ್ತದಭಾವಸುಪ್ತಿಸಮಯೇ ಸಿದ್ಧಾತ್ಮಸದ್ಭಾವತಃ ಕೋಹಂ ಭಾವಯುತಃ ಕುತೋ ವರಧಿಯಾ ದೃಷ್ಟ್ವಾತ್ಮನಿಷ್ಟಾತ್ಮನಾಂ ಸೋಹಂ ಸ್ಫೂರ್ತಿತಯಾ ಅರುಣಾಚಲಶಿವಃ ಪೂರ್ಣೋ ವಿಭಾತಿ ಸ್ವಯಂ ಕರುಣಾಪೂರ್ಣಸುಧಾಬ್ಧೇ ಕವಳಿತಘನವಿಶ್ವರೂಪ ಕಿರಣಾವಲ್ಯಾ ಅರುಣಾಚಲಪರಮಾತ್ಮನ್ ಅರುಣೋಭವಚಿತ್ತಕಂಜಸುವಿಕಾಸಾಯ ತ್ವಯಿ ಅರುಣಾಚಲಸರ್ವಂ ಭೂತ್ವಾ ಸ್ಥಿತ್ವಾ ಪ್ರಲೀನಮೇತಚ್ಚಿತ್ರಂ ಹೃದ್ಯಹಮಿತ್ಯಾತ್ಮದಯಾ ನೃತ್ಯಸಿ ಭೋಹೋ ತೇ ವದಂತಿ ಹೃದಯಂ ನಾಮ ಅಹಮಿತಿ ಕುತ ಆಯಾತೀತ್ಯನ್ವಿಷ್ಯಂತಃ ಪ್ರವಿಷ್ಟಯಾತ್ಯಮಲಧಿಯಾಂ ಅವಗಮ್ಯಸ್ವಂ ರೂಪಂ ಶಾಮ್ಯತ್ಯರುಣಾಚಲತ್ವಯಿ ನದೀವಾಬ್ಧೌ ತ್ಯಕ್ತ್ವಾ ವಿಷಯಂ ಬಾಹ್ಯಂ ರುದ್ಧಪ್ರಾಣೇನ ರುದ್ಧಮನಸಾಂತಸ್ತ್ವಾಂ ಧ್ಯಾಯನ್ ಪಶ್ಯತಿ ಯೋಗೀ ದೀಧಿತಿಂ ಅರುಣಾಚಲತ್ವಯಿ ಮಹೀಯಂ ತೇ ತ್ವಯ್ಯರ್ಪಿತಮನಸಾ ತ್ವಾಂ ಪಶ್ಯನ್ ಸರ್ವಂ ತವಾಕೃತಿತಯಾ ಸತತಂ ಭಜತೆ ಅನನ್ಯಪ್ರೀತ್ಯಾ ಸಜಯತ್ಯರುಣಾಚಲತ್ವಯಿ ಸುಖೇ ಮಗ್ನಃ. ಶೋಣಪ್ರಭಂ ಸೋಮಕಲಾವತಂಸಂ Panispurat panjasarekshu japam Pranapriyam naumi pinakapane konatrigastham kuladevatam naham Namami yaminina thalekhalankritakuntanam Bhavanim bhavasanta panirvapanasudhanadim Chudottam siddhachandracharu kalika chanjachika bhaswaru Leela dagdha vilola gama shalabhashreyo dashagre spuram Antaspur jadabara mohatimira pragbhara muchadagan Chetasadmani yoginam vijayate jnana pradipo haraham Sharada Sharadam Bhoja Vadana Vadanam Bhujim Sarvada Sarvada Smakam Sannidhim Sannidhim Kriyat Raka Chandra Samana Kanti Vadanam Naka Adirajastutam Mukanam Apikurvati Suratunini Kashavagvaibhavam Shri Kanchi Nagari Vihara Rasika Shuka Pahantri Satam Eka Punya Parampara Pashupate Akarini Rajate Yomta Pravishya Mamavaja Mimam Prasuptam Sanjeevayatya Khila Shakti Dharasvadham Nam Anyam Shahasta Charana Shravanatvagadim Pranan namo bhagavate purushaya tubhyam harihi om Avarta puryam janitam prabaddim Pandesha deshe vihritam prabaddim Shunachala prastacharam prabaddim Vikshum tapah klesha saham prabaddim Abrahma kitanta samam prabaddim Jitari Shadvargamaham Prabhadye Sarvajnata Sarabhardam Prabhadye Nissima Karunya Nidhim Prabhadye Asmat Prapanchad Adhikam Prabhadye Vishwadhikokter Vishayam Prabhadye Kalagrahagrahabhayapanutti Kritanta Shikshakritinam Prabhadye Vinetu Martim Vishayad Dvajanyam Vijnana Murtim Dadhadam Prabaddim Kandarpa Darpa Jvaravaranaya Kamari Leela Vataram Prabaddim Ajanma Varnivratinam Prabaddim Kundi Bhridam Dandadharam Prabaddim Brahmasana Dhyanaratam Prabaddim Brahmatma Bhuyam Yatinam Prabaddim Haram prabaddye vicharam prabaddye svatantratayaha sadhanam prabaddye Ameya samarthyavaham prabaddye vishuddha vijnani varam prabaddye Daurbhagyatapatraya karma moha santapahantaramaham prabaddye Yathartha sankalpam apetapapam avaptakamam vishucham prabaddye Manav prasadam bhajadam dadhanam mukdhasmitolla simukham prabaddhyem Vyatham ashesham vyapaniya muda pradena namana ramanam prabaddhyem Shivam prabaddhye shivadam prabaddhye gurum prabaddhye guninam prabaddhyem Madhiya hitpatma jusham prabaddhye sharanyamisham sharanam prabaddhyem Arunachala varakketta Aksharamanamalai shatta Karunakara ganapatiye Karamarulika appaye Arunachala shiva Arunachala shiva Arunachala shiva Arunachalam Arunachala shiva Arunachala shiva Arunachala Shiva Arunachalam Arunachalamena Ahameni Nipavar Agathe Vera Rupai Arunachalam Ayahe Sundaram Polahamum Niyumut
Mutra Bhinnamayirupum Arunachalam Aham Puhundirtum Ahaguheshirayayam Arvitadankul Arunachalam Arukkavenayandanayagatridil Akilam Paritidum Arunachalam Ipparita Punayin Ninaipittain Iniyar Viduvar Arunachalam Indridumannayir Peridarul Purivoy Iduo Unadarul Arunachalam Unaye Matrin Odadullatin Melurudiyayirupay Arunachalam Urshutrulam Vidadunai Kandadangida Unnayahai Kattarunachalam Enayalithippodenai Kalavavidil Iduo Anmai Arunachalam Eninda Urakkam Enai Pirarizhukka Idu Unakkazhago Arunachalam Aimbulakanvar Ahathinir Puhumbod Ahathini Illayo Arunachalam Uruvanam Unnai Olithevar Varuvar Unshude Idu Arunachalam Arunachala Shiva Arunachala Shiva Arunachala Shiva Arunachalam Arunachala Shiva Arunachala Shiva Arunachala Shiva Arunachalam Arukkavenai Andanai Agatridil Akilam Palithidum Arunachalam இப்படி தப்பு உனை ஏன் நினைப்பித்தாய் இனியார் விடுவார் அருணாச்சலம் The fourth verse yesterday we saw Bhagavan expressing His bhava to Arunachalam. In the introduction, Kanakamma has written on the peaceful, solitary, and shady slope of Arunachalam. In the solemn, sweet quietude of the innermost tabernacle of his heart, what transpired between him and his Lord Arunachalam? The wonder of devotion, of prema bhakti, consummating in non-dual union is unraveled by Bhagavan in verses couched in sentiments of bridal bliss. The effect of these verses, an outpouring of intensely ecstatic devotion, is heightened and enriched by the use of the imagery of bridal mysticism. Yesterday we saw Bhagavan expressing how Arunachala's grace entered his life in Madurai, and from Madurai he was pulled to Tiruvannamalai and kept captive here, or how he was pulled out of the body awareness and kept established in the inner self. So, there is that inner in-between state where the seeker has decided to determine to attain the ultimate. The thirst for, or we cannot say simply thirst, a taste of that divine is revealed to him. And once it is revealed, he cannot leave it. He cannot live satisfied with ordinary pleasures of the world. So he is neither here nor is he established there. So this state is expressed by, actually this is what they call mysticism. Many seekers, you know, they are very fond of this word, mysticism. Actually, there is nothing called mysticism. Mysticism means jnana corrupted by ignorance. Little bit of ignorance remains. So, Bhagavan somewhere says, this modaka. I don't know, those who have lived in Ramanasram in Tiruvannamalai for long years, they might be knowing it. A sweet thing which Ganapati keeps in his hand. It is called modaka. And that modaka, inside is sweetness. And that sweetness has its own name. It is called Purna. Purna means whole, infinite. It is made of coconut and jaggery. So it is called Purna, and the outer covering, that salt rice covering, is put around it, and then they call it Modaka. It is a kind of symbol. Usually children, every Vinayaka Chaturthi, a celebration in the name of Ganapati, they will make this modaka, this sweet, as a nivedya, as prasad. So we children, we have almost everyone, children, they do it. They will get disgusted by this covering. Because this covering adulterates the inner sweetness. But old people, they will love to have that adulteration. They will want that sweetness mixed with salt. So that sweet, that salt covering, they have to toil much to put it around. So children, usually they will be wondering why these old people do this. Because you can directly taste the Purna inside. It is, actually the taste is only of that inner thing. You can eat that Purna without salt, but you cannot eat that salty stuff without the inner Purna. So, in this viraha, the pain of separation, in these mystics they say, there is a bliss in this pain of separation. Actually, the bliss is not of the pain. It is the bliss of the self that you get in between. So that bliss comes from the self. And once you have got it in the pure form, you don't want to stay away from it. But your weakness, your body, your mind, your worldly failings, they pull you back. So in that state, all devotees, all saints, all seekers, they have wept their way to it. See, this is one point that I want to stress. The thing is, there is certain seekers, they think that the guilt that you carry within should be removed. And they find some justification that whatever is happening through you, they bring the highest teaching of non-doership into the seeker state and they say, I am not the doer. But the happiness, the joy will not come. As long as the body and mind carry the dross, the disorder, you cannot be established in that state. You can see the thing happening in all saints. They wept, they burnt the dross in the fire of that dispassion. And that dispassion or the pain of separation itself is the austerity, is the fire in which they burnt the dross. You cannot escape. You cannot escape it. And of course that is blissful. That is delightful. Because you are nearing that absolute purity. So, we cannot see this kind of things in Bhagavan's life. Bhagavan is like a rocket. You can see 5 minutes before there was Venkataraman, 5 minutes after there was Ramana Maharshi. You don't see in Bhagavan's life a sadhaka seeking, doing this sadhana, weeping, attaining. These things we do not see in Bhagavan's life. But the mystery is, Bhagavan himself said about Shankaracharya, somebody asked. Shankaracharya has written verses where he tells Lord, Lord, my mind is wandering. I have no control over my senses. I have this desire, that desire. All these things Shankaracharya writes in verse form. So some devotee asked Bhagavan, Bhagavan, how could Shankaracharya write this? See, because these modern, peculiar kind of people are there. Research scholars. They do research in everything. And they do research in the works of saints. And they say these saints had all these experiences. So somebody took these verses to Bhagavan and said, Bhagavan, how could Shankaracharya write these verses? Bhagavan said, why not? Then did he pass through all these experiences in his life? Bhagavan said, not necessarily. They can take the state of any seeker, identify with him and write. It is not for them that they wrote for you. They wrote for the seeker. Once they become one with the truth, they become one with everyone. That is why in Bhagavan's life you see absolute purity, but that purity includes all impurity. He can understand our impurity. He can be sympathetic with our imperfection. That perfection includes all imperfections. Either you can explain it by the rebirth theory, that they have traveled through all lives, all kind of states in their past birth. Or you can explain it by saying that the moment they realize the truth, they are sarvajna. The Upanishad says, yes sarvajna, yes sarvavite, yes jnanamayam tapaham. Divye Brahmapure Hyesha Vyomnyatma Pratishthita Manomaya Prana Sharira Neta Pratishthitonni Hridayam Sannidhaya Tad Vijnanena Paripashyanti Dhiraha Anandarupam Amritam Yadvibhati. Shruti says, the self is all knowing. That is what yesterday we told, Ishvara Sharira. In Yoga Sutra, Patanjali says, there is the seed of omniscience in everyone. In the Jnani, that seed explodes perhaps. So if necessary, the Shankaracharya and Dakshinamurti Stotra says, a Jnani need not be omniscient always. But if necessary, omniscience will manifest all knowingness will manifest. Any knowledge, if necessary, it will come. Because knowledge is also a kind of dirt. That is why Shankaracharya put that word, if necessary. If it can help you, they will use knowledge. So that omniscience is there in a jnani. So he can take the bhava of any seeker and go through it. He need not necessarily take a body for that. So Bhagavan, for helping us, he knows that we cannot go to that state like him. Just one day, see, I am a very traditional person. So I don't know many of these modern words. Somebody told me, they have an ashram. They told me, we are having a workshop. And I was wondering, why is ashram should run a workshop? Perhaps to repair their car or scooter or motorbike. I could not understand why an ashram should have a workshop. Then only later on I came to know that they call the spiritual things are also as workshop. Actually, spirituality is a no workshop. There is no work. Bhagavan used to say, Pani ledu vadu. In Telugu, he used to express, we are people without any work. I said this because I heard that people imitate Bhagavan. That Bhagavan closing the room, keeping their body stretched, telling themselves that now death has come and the body dies. The body will be taken to cremation ground, will be burnt, and after 5 minutes, snoring. And Bhagavan got realization, we will get sleep. It is not lying down or imitating death, but that attention was razor sharp. And his power to go beyond the pull of the gravitational pull of the body was tremendous. So he very much knew that we cannot imitate him. So that compassion is God. So that Ishwaratva made him give us this tonic called Aksharamanamalai. This Rasayanam. In Ayurveda, tonic is known as Rasayanam. This Rasayanam called Aksharamanamalai. We see Bhagavan and we see our littleness. We see his perfection and we become conscious of our imperfection. And the way in between, we have to cover it with tears, with austerity, with tremendous alertness, with self-inquiry. Bhagavan has given us that weapon with which you can cut that difference. Where arukar. The difference between you and him, you cut with a sword, with a brahmastra. And that brahmastra is Atma Vichara. Who am I? So, here Bhagavan expresses, he asks Arunachalam, you came with your sweet will and possessed me and pulled me here and kept me locked in your heart cave. And then in the next verse he asks, Arkavane Andanai. Who asked you to enslave me? For whose sake did you claim and possess me? If you who ruled over me with concern were now to desert me with indifference, will not the entire world reproach thee? The entire world will tell in Manikyavachakam, in Tiruvachakam, he expresses the same kind of feelings. In one song he says, he is not like Bhagavan, because Bhagavan is Eka Bhakta. Arunachala, over, no other name. In Tiruvachakam, Manikavachakam sings about Nadaraja, he sings about other, all Shiva temples he goes and sings. So in one song, there is a temple near Rameshwaram, and that place is Uttarakoshamankai. And that Lord, certain verses are offered there. In those verses, Manikyavachakar says, Lord, you have, now the world knows that I am a Shiva Bhakta. But I know that I am not perfect. I have not completely attained you. So I will move about freely in this world and display my imperfections, display my weakness. Everything I will show to others. And when people ask me, whose devotee you are, I will tell them, I am a great devotee of Uttarakoshamangai. And your name will be tarnished. Everybody will keep their finger on their nose. Being a devotee of the Lord, he behaves like this. So that your name alone will get tarnished. So if you want to escape from that blame, make me one with you. Do not keep me away from you. If you want to escape, make me one with you. If I keep myself as a separate person, naturally weakness will be there. Imperfections will be there. All dross will be there. So if you want to prove to the world, show the glory of Arunachala to the world, make me one with you. So ippadi tappu. Bhagavan says, this pari means blame. If you want to escape this blame, escape from this blame, you give me your grace. You bestow your grace. There is no other way. Yen ninai pittai. Why did you make me think about you? See, in Bhagavatam, these Gopikas use this same kind of tone to Krishna. There is one song in Bhagavatam, Bhramara Gitam, where they say, you should not believe these black people. Because Krishna is black. They say, these black people you should not believe. Because the moment you see that Krishna, he smiles at you and you forget the world. And will he stay with you permanently? He will not. He will leave you. Then you are in a complete pain, suffering. So this kind of emotion, bhava, sentiment, Bhagavan expresses in this song, Ippai tappunai yen inai pittai, ini yar viduvar Arunachala. Arunachala, escape from this infamy. Why did you make me remember you? Who will let you go henceforth? Now, nobody will like to leave this experience, this joy. The Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, in his gospel, there is one incident. One of his, the devotee who wrote Gospel of Ramakrishna, Master Mahashay, he comes the first day, and slowly after 2 days again he comes, then again he comes, then Ramakrishna says, these people used to catch peacocks, First, they will give some opium to this peacock. That drug. The moment peacock consumes it, right at the same time, the peacock will come next day. So, Ramakrishna said, seeing this master Mahashay coming to him, devotees coming again and again, they have consumed the drug. Once it goes within, it is impossible to leave it. So, Bhagavan said, who will leave you now? It is impossible to leave you. Who will let thee go? That I have seen it many times. See, people, they come to satsang, they come to Bhagavata Saptah, they come to lectures. They will be almost like these drug addicts. And they will have family problems. Their family people will not be liking this. There will be troubles. And they will say, from tomorrow onwards, I will not come. Lot of trouble in home. And next day you can see, correct, right at the time they will be there. If you ask, why did you come? We don't know. We could not resist. So, that spiritual attraction, that spiritual pull is irresistible. So, Bhagavan here says, who will let you go henceforth, Arunachalam? Indridum, then Bhagavan comes back to mother. See, he feels so much motherliness in Arunachalam. The affection of mother in Arunachalam. This is the place where divine mother merged. Actually, in Arunachaleshwara temple history, they say there was no separate temple for Abhita Kuchambal. Later on only that temple came. Formerly, that divine mother was one with Arunachala. There was no necessity. Because Arunachala himself is Ammayappan. He is father and mother both. When saint Ramalinga Swamigan, he sings, my position is very difficult, Lord, he says. Because for a child, if the mother gets angry, he will run to his father. If his father beats him, he will run to his mother. But for me, there is only one. This side is father, that side is mother. Both is in a single person. Taditta or maganai tandai thayirn dadittal tandai udan anaippan. Tandai adittal thay anaippan. தாய் அடித்தால் பிடித்தொரு தந்தை அணைப்பனிங்கெனக்கு பேசிய தந்தையும் தாயும் பொடித்திருமேனி அம்பலத்தாடும் புனிதனி ஆதலால் என்னை அடித்தது போதும் அணைத்திடல் வேண்டும் அம்மையப்பா இனி ஆற்றேன். சோ பியூட்டிஃபுல். ஹி கால்ஸ் லார்ட் யுவர் அம்மையப்பன் மீன்ஸ் யுவர் மதர் அண்ட் ஃபாதர். யூ ஹாவ் கிவன் மீ லாட் ஆஃப் பீட்டிங்ஸ். Now stop it. It is enough. He says, it is enough. Now please hug me. Give me that great healing tonic of your grace. So here, Bhagavan again comes back to mother principle. Yesterday we told, you know, Bhagavan after realization, when we say self, when we say consciousness, and certain people, to give example, they give the example of electricity, light, all those things for consciousness. But usually, for seekers, when these words come to our ears, it gives a kind of tone of a kind of inert energy, like electricity, like chemicals, or like some force in nature. But consciousness means God, Ishvara. Bhagavan in one place says, consciousness purged of all dross shines forth as God. This is there in talks. Somebody asks Bhagavan, what is God? Bhagavan says, consciousness purged of all dross, all limitations when they are lifted. Consciousness shines forth as God. And God means what? God means love. God means compassion. God means bliss. And the greatest manifestation of God is motherliness. Motherliness manifests in a woman for the protection of that infant for temporarily for a period. It is not that she is the mother. She, for that time, for those period, she becomes a mother. Actually, divine mother enters her. The motherhood of the Lord manifests through her. I had a vision of this once. I was staying in one place. One series of talk was going on in Malayalam. In the place where I was staying, they were having some 2-3 cats in their house. Cat, one of their pet cat, it gave birth to kittens and it fell into a well and died. These small babies, mother cat was not there to feed, and the child in that house was very much worried how to make this kitten grow, how to feed them, because you cannot give them milk through some bottle, they are so small. And the mystery is, you know, another cat came and it identified with the mother of these babies, and milk was also coming. It was feeding those babies. And they also asked some doctor, what is this phenomenon known? Medical science, you know, they have a best way of covering wonders. That is by stamping, giving some name. If you give some name, you stop inquiry. And they said that is pseudo-pregnancy. They said that is pseudo-pregnancy. That means you think that you have explained. What does it mean? It means that the real mother is not the cat. The real mother is the compassion of nature. Nature means Ishvara, compassion of the Lord. And when it wants to protect a creature, it manifests in some form. That is why in our Purana we say, Lord manifested in a pillar, in an inert thing. If he wants to manifest, he can manifest anywhere. So, in Bhagavan also, he manifested. Arunachaleshwara manifested. That is why Paul Brenton said, when I saw Maharshi, I recognized that he was not a person. He was a pure channel for that white light of grace to descend, flow through. So that motherliness, that is our subject. Next song, Bhagavan says, ஈன்றிடும் அன்னையில் பெரிதருள் புரிவோய் இது ஓகுனது அருள் அருணாச்சலா. பகவான் சேஸ், அருணாச்சலா, யூ ஆர் மோர் கம்பேஷனேட் தேன் ஒன்ஸ் ஓன் மதர். A mother who sacrifices so much to protect a child. You are more compassionate than a human mother. Indridum annair peridu arul purivoi. You are more gracious, more compassionate than a human mother. Iduvo unadu arul Arunachala. Arunachala, is this your grace? That means I am suffering here. I am left alone. Having given that inebriating elixir, now I am thirsty. I cannot drink anything else. I should get that only. So please do not leave me. Iduvo unadarul Arunachala. You are more compassionate than mother Arunachala. For Bhagavan, Arunachala was, we know, Bhagavan once said, that son, I am your son, you are my father. And he came to Tiruvannamalai, he just embraced the lingam and said, Father, I have come obeying your call, and now you alone, your will alone prevails. So these were Bhagavan's words. Here Bhagavan says, you are more compassionate than any human mother. That means you are the real mother. So when a devotee, he comes out of the world. Mata nasti, pita nasti, nasti bandhuhu sahodaraha. Artham nasti, griham nasti, tasma jagrata jagrata. For a sannyasi, there is no mother, no father, but he finds mothers and fathers everywhere. That is why Shankaracharya, who left his home when he was only 8 years old, nobody has written so much devotional verses on Divine Mother. Because they know the value of mother. They know what motherhood is. And they found Divine Mother everywhere. When he was in Kashi, he sang Annapurna. When he went to Kashmir, he saw Sharada. When he came to Sringeri, he saw Sharada. When Kanchi, he saw Kamakshi. Wherever he went, Divine Mother manifested before him in various manifold forms. See, bhakti means, Bhagavan in one place said, recognition of the self is jnana and inundation of self is bhakti. Bhakti is not separate from jnana. Sadhana bhakti may be different. But in that siddhavastha, that parabhakti, where Bhagavan says, where there is no difference, abhinna bhava, you become one with the Lord. There, you find Lord everywhere in all forms. You can see that compassion. Bhagavan as a boy, he came. You know, Seshadri Swami, such a great sage. He was wandering around Arunachala like a mad person. Sometimes, you know what he will do? He will take a red sari and put it in his head. And he will say, I am Parvati and my child Subramanya is there. He used to identify himself with the Divine Mother Parvati. And he will say, Bhagavan is my child Subramanya. So that feeling of protection, perhaps he reflected only that motherliness of Arunachala, which was around, pervading everywhere. They are only like radio station or television channels. They can just reflect what is there. So many times he used to identify with the Divine Mother. And Bhagavan was looked after with so much compassion by Arunachala. Indridum ammayir peridarul. It is not an ordinary expression. He says, he knew Ayagammal. He knew Ayagammal's love. And he says, Arunachala is the fulfillment of Ayagammal. Because not a single Arhamal. That Mudaliyar party was there, Echama was there, Kirei party was there, and many, many forms, in many, many forms, Arunachaleshwara appeared before Bhagavan and fondled him. You can see that in Bhagavan's life. Instead of seeing it like a history, if you just melt and become one with it, you will see what Bhagavan expresses in Aksharamanamalai is only what was demonstrated to him in his life. So, Indridum Annayir Peridu Arul Purivoy. You are more compassionate, Arunachala, you are more compassionate than Indridum Annai means human mother. The mother of this physical body. Peridarul Purivoy. Iduvo unadarul Arunachala. The grace of Ishvara as mother is different from human mother. See, human mother will say, if you feel hungry, she will cook food for you. She will, if you become sleepy, she will make you sleep. But the divine mother, Arunachala, if you feel hungry, he will make you beg. If you feel sleepy, he will ask you not to sleep. He will make you rapagalilla veru veli, sleepless. It is a little bit different. See, once Muruganar Swami, he left everything and came. Yesterday I told that incident where he had to go for begging, though there was no other way. He lost everything. He came, almost became a beggar. And his wife, Meenakshi Ammal, she used to come often to Bhagavan and tell Bhagavan, Bhagavan, why have you caught my husband? Enslaved my husband. Why don't you leave him to me? Bhagavan said, I have tried many times. What to do? I didn't ask him to come. He came of his own free will. And Bhagavan, actually he tried many times to make Muruganar go back. But he could not. Muruganar wrote some songs in that bridal bhava, which they, bridal mysticism or something which they said now. Muruganar also wrote to Bhagavan that you are the Lord, Ramana Mayavani. Bhagavan took those songs and made Meenakshi Amma by heart that, and Bhagavan asked her to sing before Muruganar. Instead of Ramana Mayavan, Bhagavan put the word Muruga Mayavan. Muruganar just stood up and went out. Then Bhagavan said, oh, you still feel that she is your wife. And Bhagavan said, so you have not left. He could neither go, nor was his stay in Tiruvannamalai comfortable. That is the position. And he could neither perform some acts in the world with precision. See, this is the peculiar state into which a seeker comes. And the whole world looks at him, they feel, is this spirituality? We cannot explain that state because they have to go through that state. Muruganar Swami, when he was in ashram, and somebody in ashram, they told, why don't you do puja in Matru Bhudeshwara? Now you see priests are appointed. In those days, somebody will do. And they have to do that bell ringing and do aarti. The difficulty with Muruganar is, if he starts doing aarti, this will stop. This bell will stop. If we start shaking the bell, this arati will stop.
He found it is very difficult.
That simple thing of doing arati with that money is so difficult for him. He finds it as a great gymnastics, acrobatics. And one day, when he was with Bhagavan inside kitchen. See, when you are inside ashram, every place should remind you of Bhagavan's presence. See, the place where we sit now, these are the areas where he has walked. And the old kitchen, this side is a new kitchen, and through that area also Bhagavan has walked. And the old kitchen is the place where he has cooked. And the place where the photo is kept, there he has sat and taken food with the devotees. And he used to come often to the kitchen and cut vegetables. So sometimes devotees will also follow him. Actually, they followed him not for doing some service, but the thing is, they can be with him. Bhagavan will work with so much precision, perfection, and he will do that. Grinding that dosha maavu. So one devotee, he found Bhagavan's fingers were all in blisters. He said, Bhagavan, why do you toil like this? I will work. Bhagavan didn't listen. Actually, many Swamis of Ramakrishna Math, they have told, in former days, they have seen Bhagavan in kitchen while he is working. So Bhagavan was doing this grinding work. One close devotee, he deliberately, with force, he took that from Bhagavan's hand and said, Bhagavan, I will do it. Bhagavan just gave it and went near the stove and started cooking there. It was more burning. This devotee again deliberately took it from Bhagavan. You know, Bhagavan, what he told him, see, in those former days, I used to beg in the town and take bhiksha. So I was not I was feeling so free that I am not taking anything more from any person. I was not receiving anything free of cost. But here, he never considered ashram as his property. So he says, here they give me free food. So I feel like doing something here. Now you have taken my work. So give me your clothes. I will wash them. So this was Bhagavan's bhava attitude. So one day Bhagavan came for cutting vegetables. This Muruganar also came with Bhagavan. He is one person who can either write poetry or can teach, but nothing else. So, but he also wanted to work with Bhagavan. He came to cut vegetables. Bhagavan was doing it so precisely. Muruganar, the moment he looks at Bhagavan, he will be lost. Just like Bhagavan, when he looks at Arunachala, he will be lost. So to Muruganar, the moment he looks at Bhagavan, Bhagavan jokingly used to say, vaayile ee chava ee pona kuda theriyathu. He will be sitting there with his mouth open. Something will enter his mouth, Bhagavan used to remark. Just like that, he will be sitting there. So he came to kitchen and started cutting vegetables. Bhagavan was doing it so perfectly. While Muruganar, you know, he just took some vegetable, did a horrible work, all cacophony there, put some here, put some there, all, it was like a battleground. Bhagavan, after, he was narrating some old stories, some stories when he was living in the hill, something he was doing, narrating. After a few minutes, Bhagavan kept his knife aside and looked at the place where Muruganar was sitting. Then said, "It looks just like you run your family life." Neer kuduthanam nadathina maadhiriye irukku. Then Muruganar became, he is a very sentimental person. He became affected spiritually. He wrote a poem expressing that you pulled me, gave me this taste, and I have become useless to the world. Now you want me to go back and run a family life? You know how to run a family life very well. Why do you wander about in the street of Arunachala naked begging for food? Why don't you run a good, perfect family life? That is the song. Nakkaragi nayandu ramanare, pukku pichai pulambi thirivaden, takkavaruru thayyaludaviyar chikkana kudivalke shalutthume. You know how to run a family with chikkana thikana shalutthu. Not simply frugal, with thrift. A frugal or thrift or very controlled, orderly family life. So why don't you do that? Instead of that, you go on wandering this Arunachala, fully, almost fully naked, begging your food here and there. So it's just, see that bhava. He wrote that song and kept it. You cannot sing that song in front of Bhagavan. So, that is there in the collection of songs. So that state where they are brought to Tiruvannamalai. But, see, one day, Muruganar every day used to take food by begging. Bhagavan allowed him to suffer. Because Bhagavan knew that is compassion in a higher state. Human compassion is sentiment. That may be good, may not be good for you. Somebody asked Bhagavan, sometimes Lord is not answering our prayer. Then Bhagavan said, perhaps it is for your good that he is not answering your prayer. Sometimes, when the Lord gives you trial, suffering, it is for your good. And in Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord says, the devotee whom I love, I will see to it that he becomes a pauper. All his wealth is plundered. I will see to it that he is in the streets. In that Mahabali story, where Lord took away everything from that king, he appeared as a small brahmachari and said, I want only 3 feet earth. Then Mahabali said, this boy is too innocent to live in the world. Because he asks only for 3 feet land. That too measured by my small feet. Then that king said, you boy, you are not worthy to live in this world. How will you live in this world? See, I am a big emperor. When you come to me, you should ask for a lot of wealth or vast land, or you ask even a country from me, I will give it to you. Why do you ask for small piece of land? No, no. I want only 3 feet of land measured by my feet. Then this person succumbed. He gave. Suddenly that colossal form appeared and measured whatever the king held as his own with 2 feet. And there is no place for the 3rd foot. Then Lord asked, you said I will give you 3 feet. Now I have taken everything from you with 2 feet. Where is the 3rd foot? The 2 feet is I and mine. The 3rd foot is thy. Bhagavan, when Paul Brinton asked Bhagavan, Bhagavan, should I not sacrifice all my possessions? Then Bhagavan said, the possessor too. Possessions you hold as yours. So when this king gave everything to Lord, then Lord said, where is the place for my 3rd foot? Then Mahabali said, Lord, you are my master. You are my guru. Because all worldly people who love us, who are affectionate to us, they will do good to us by giving something. But by giving, you can never make a person complete. You only know the art of making a person perfect whole by removing whatever accretions are there around him. He took away everything from me and now I find that I am absolutely free. I don't need these things. Now you want the 3rd place where your feet is not, keep it in my head. Bhagavan in Padigam says to Arunachala, Arunachala, keep your feet in my head. Talayinil virimalar padattinai vaitte. Arunachala, keep your feet in my head. That story is there. So Lord said, this is how I bless devotees. When I want to bless a person, I will see to it that whatever he has is taken away from him. That is how I behave with devotees whom I love. Then one devotee told Lord, that is why you have very few devotees. You create so much problem in this world. See, there was one great saint in Maharashtra, Tukaram. He sang so many songs in the name of Vettel, that Panduranga. His wife, the moment she sees the form of Panduranga, she will be terrific. You know, she will sometimes take broomstick, the worst thing that you can take against Lord. She will tell this black-faced one knows only one thing, to foil the life of a family man. He created all troubles in my life. So Lord here says, that is how I bless. Esya anugraham icchami tad visho vidhunomyaham. The verse says, wherever his ego is lodged, there I will hit. Whatever he hold on to as beloved, dear to him, I will plunder it, pull it away from him. Then he will find that there is more space in him. He needs nothing from the world to be. Then he will find that I already exist in him. Because he is holding to other things, he is not able to experience me. When everything is being taken away from him, then he will not feel the voidness. Instead, he will feel full, whole. It is like a spiritual surgery. So Bhagavan here says, Eendridum ammayir peridarul purivoi. Iduvo unadarul Arunachala. Arunachala, you are more gracious than a human mother. Please reveal thy grace. Please show me thy grace. How should I show my grace? Then Bhagavan says, Unaye matri oda adulatin mel urudiya irupai Arunachala. Then what is the seeker seeking? What do you want from me? What are you really asking from the Lord, from Arunachala, from Master, from Bhagavan? Bhagavan here says, this mind is running around the whole world, roaming about. Urshutrulam. It roams. Vidadu unikandu. Unaye matri odadu ulatin. This mind, you know, it deceives you. The mind knows how to deceive Lord. It, instead of deceiving you, let it leave the world. Unaye matri odadu, O Lord. Urudiyayirupai. Bhagavan says, O Lord, you be established in my heart. Reveal yourself completely. It means flickerless experience of the self. When the mind moves, the experience of the self is spasmodic. In between each and every thought, it is there. But thought gives a covering. Thoughts cover the self. So, and ematri and unaye matri. Matri means, it tells you that you are the body, you are the mind, you are a woman, you are a man, you belong to this place. All kind of superimposition is being given to you by this constant bluffing agent within the mind. So Bhagavan says, in talks someplace, when devotee asks, Bhagavan, what is mind? Answers of Bhagavan are not same everywhere. In one place Bhagavan says, mind means limitation on the self. If there is no mind, there is no limitation. Mind means limitation on the self. The self is limited as a particular thought, as the body, as a person, as a jiva. The first emergence of mind is as I. Deep sleep, there is no I, there is no mind. Bhagavan in one place says, I is mind. I is all thoughts. All thoughts are made of I only. Just like this cloth is made of threads. So too, the mind is full of threads, and each thread is nothing but I. The mind runs through the senses. It moves because of this I. To stop that movement, Urudiya irupai, Bhagavan says, you have to recognize the self. Urudi means firm. You need not cultivate mental firmness, but you have to recognize the changeless nature of the self. In Bhagavan's teaching, it is pure Vedanta, where Bhagavan never gives you any direct sadhana. You can see it when you read talks. You can see devotees will be constantly pestering Bhagavan to give them some technique. But Bhagavan will say, you are already that. What do you want to do? You fail to recognize. And your very nature is freedom. If you recognize yourself, there is no mind in you. For a seeker, he might find these answers almost unreachable. But ultimately you will see that is the only perfect solution for the problems. Where Bhagavan in Aksharamanamalai one place says, stand naked before me, Arunachala. It means the self shining forth without the limitation of the body or the mind or the ego. The I, uruti, means firmness. Only when you recognize the I as the self, not as the body or the mind or the ego, but when you seek the I, when you constantly observe the real nature of the I, the real nature of the mind, when you recognize it as pure awareness, chit, then you know that you need no more meditation to keep it firm. Firmness is its very nature. You need even no kind of samadhi to be in that. It is not a mental state, it is your real nature. It is the very nature of the self. That is what Bhagavan calls as uruti. If that uruti has come, that dardyam has come, that pure, unflinching experience has come, then even if the mind wanders, there is nothing wrong in it. Because yatra yatra mano yati, tatra tatra samadhaya. Shankaracharya says, wherever the mind moves, in there, jnani has samadhi. Wherever the mind goes, tat brahmanaha tatra darshanam. Another verse, he says, wherever the mind goes, the realized person beholds only Brahman there, Ishvara there. So he needs no kind of special trance for him to keep him in that state. With open eyes, he looks only at Arunachala. In Arunachala Panjaratnam, Bhagavan says, that is uruti, experience. It is not that only when you close your eyes, it is there. With open eyes, you see everyone as Arunachala. A very beautiful incident in Bhagavan's life. During Kartike Deepam, nowadays you see the whole Tiruvannamalai is crowded. Every Pournami, you cannot cross the road. So many people. But few decades back, there will be very few devotees coming. And during Kartike Deepam only it will be crowded. And in Bhagavan's time, usually these village people around Tiruvannamalai, they will come. And they will take a dip in each pond around this hill. And with wet clothes, they will do giri pradakshanam. And Bhagavan will be sitting in his couch, radiating grace, looking with so much joy at these devotees. Annamalai Swami used to say he always had some partiality with simple people. Very big scholars will come. Bhagavan will not even make a small movement. But some ordinary person will come. He will talk. He will inquire many things. So when these village people come, Bhagavan either will talk to them or we will be sitting, emanating grace. But naturally the other devotees, they felt it very bad because these people will be stinking. And wet also, with dirty clothes. So all of them will come and they sometimes will touch Bhagavan's body, extending their hands. So, ashram devotees, many devotees thought how to protect Bhagavan. They wanted to protect Bhagavan. You cannot go and tell Bhagavan that, Bhagavan, we will not give darshan to these devotees. It is impossible. So, they, in between them, they decided something. And they told the attendant near Bhagavan to take the railings. You see that railings even now. That fence-like thing. So they told him, when Bhagavan goes for his walk, that trick, before he comes back, you take that railings and keep it in a distance. So that these people will come in a distance queue, have darshan and go. I think perhaps that side of meditation room, yeah, the old hall. That andhapakkama dhaan varuva, yeah. The Kartikeya Deepam, in the door, illayo. Adhu irukku, andhapakkam irukku. Rendume open, yeah. So these devotees will come in a distance and they will not touch, come near. So this attendant was doing his job. At that time Bhagavan came. And Bhagavan looked at him and asked, what are you doing? His name was Krishna Swami. He dropped his body only 10-15 years back. So Bhagavan asked him, what are you doing? He said, Bhagavan, all these dirty people will come. They will be wet, stinking. They will even come near you, touch you. So better that they go in a distance. So devotees have decided that we will keep this railings in a distance so that they will not come near you. Then Bhagavan said, why do you do that? Because tomorrow Kartikeya Deepam, so many people will come and Bhagavan will be giving them darshan from morning to evening. Bhagavan will not have a rest. Oh, so you think. Then Bhagavan didn't say, you put the railings back. Because he will never cancel any decision taken by the authorities or devotees. But he had to correct. So he said, now you have obeyed them. You obey me also. You take this couch and put it there. So the plan was foiled. Then he asked Bhagavan, we are doing it only for your good. Bhagavan said, oh, you think this is good for me? You think all these poor people come to have my darshan? And Swami is giving them darshan? Do you know who are coming? They are all various forms of Arunachalam. Arunachala Swarupam. We should get their darshan.
That is why this sitting. Adukkutha in the irupu. We should get their darshan. It's a very beautiful story. It is an explanation of Bhagavan's fifth verse in Arunachala Pancharatnam. Agilamum unnuruvai anniyamil anbusheyum annoon Arunachala velgum. In Sanskrit also Bhagavan uses the same word. Sajjayati. Sanskrit Bhagavan says Sajjayati. And Tamil Bhagavan uses the word velgum. That is the ultimate victory of spiritual practice. The ultimate victory of spiritual practice is there when you see divine with open eyes. You need no special practice to be in the Lord. Because you know that there is nothing apart from self. Atmaiva idam sarvam. Nothing exists separate from the self. Bhagavan, he will not answer. He will always ask a question. Is there anything apart from the self? Anyamaha yadavad irukko. So there is nothing apart from the self. Everything is self. And ignorance or mind, ignorance means to see anything other than the self. And that recognition of the other itself is mind. Ignorance is mind. And knowledge is self. Intelligence is self. Ignorance puts limitation in the self as man, woman, tree. See, in Veda there is a mantra. The mantra says, what is this tree? Kagum svidvrakshaha kim tadvanam. The mantra asks a question, what is this tree made of? What is this forest made of? Brahmavanam. Brahmasa vriksha asit. The mantra says, this vriksha, this tree is Brahman. And this forest is Brahman. It was Brahman. Now out of your ignorance, you see it as a tree or as a forest. And the tree never claims itself as a tree. Only you give the name, this tree, that tree, mango tree, coconut tree. But for it, it is only an existence. Only you give a name and form. Lift the name and form, drop the name and form. Only that, satta chit sukharupam asti satatam. Ever, constantly, existence, awareness, and bliss, joy, shanti, that peace of the self alone is. The moment you lose hold of it, mind comes. And mind means what? Recognizing anything apart from the self. And that recognition is vasana. There is nothing other than it as vasana. Vasana means only ignorance. Wherever ignorance is not removed, there either you are attracted or you are repelled. Attachment is there or repulsion is there. Remove that ignorance. Know that nothing is there apart from the self. When that ignorance is lifted, mind ceases to exist because mind needs ignorance to thrive. Mind needs the tonic of
diversity to live. It cannot live with that non-dual awareness. And for Bhagavan, there was no separate samadhi state. You can see that there is no special ritual, there is no special practice. This few, 2-3 hours he will be in anushtana, nothing like that. Rappagalilla varuveli. Bhagavan uses a term in Aksharamanamalai, Lord, you have put me in that state where there is neither day nor night. And you know what day and night means? Shankaracharya in one place gives definition to day and night. He says, grasping is day, ignorance is night. And in pure awareness, there is neither grasping nor ignorance. Just in deep sleep you see, you don't know anything. And in waking state and dream, there are grasping thoughts. Grahana, agrahana. Grahana means grasping. Agrahana means not grasping. So not knowing is night, knowing is day, and the self is neither not knowing nor knowing. It is pure, self-effulgent beingness as I. Uninterrupted experience of existence. Sattachit sukham. And once you find your way into that center, somehow you swim into that center. Somehow you make a plunge into that center. And identify that as you. Tatra atmatvam dridhi kurvan. See, that is, for that alone, a seeker has to wait with a master. We say he has to live with a guru, because guru is not going to do any magic. But you can call it a magic, because at a particular moment when you are ready to grasp it, the Upanishad gives the example of the bow and arrow. Taking the Upanishad dhanurgrihitva aupanishadam mahastram. The Shruti says, the knowledge of pure knowledge of the self is the bow. And attention is the arrow. Actually, the Upanishad says the disciple has to do it. But you can take it as the master. What does he do? The knowledge of the self is the bow, and attention is the arrow. With it, at the right opportune moment, interval where your mind is not aware. You cannot say, you are fully aware, but the mind is not interrupting. He will wait for that moment to shoot. Ban chadaya guru ne. The Kabir says, my master hit me with an arrow. I became blind to the world. I was lost. I was killed. He says, so that hitting with an arrow of attention, with that grace, or the right moment, for that the seeker has to wait. At a right moment, the master makes you abide. Sit in yourself. Atmanishtha. Tatra atmatvam dridhi kuru. Ahamadishu santyaja. The master says, identify yourself with what you got now and leave your identity with the ego, mind, etc. Look at your ego or mind as you will look at this mic or this book or this timepiece or this pillar. They are only objects in nature. Some objects are seen outside in nature. Some objects are seen within in nature. But both are only nature. You are not nature. You are the truth. You are Brahman. You are the pure self. Identify with it and live without losing that identity either by sleep or by talk or by activity or by any course of events in your life. Let not any event has the power to shake you from that center. Either by disease of the body or by some mind, mental problem, if you are not shaken from that center, that is unadulterated, immaculate jnana, intelligence jnana. Dehendriyadi, dehendriya prana manodhyamyo, janmapeyakshut bhaya tarshakrichvaihi, samsara dharmaihi, avimuhyamanaha, smritya harehe bhagavata pradhana. Bhagavatam says, either by the body or by the prana, means hunger, thirst, or by the proclivities of the mind, movements of the mind, not at all affected, you gain such clear perception of the self that you never lose it. It remains flickerless in your heart. And in one place, Vidyaranya Swami gives an example of a dancing girl. Bhagavan loved that example very much. The dancing girl, she keeps a pot. It is usually seen in Tamil Nadu. Karahatam, they will say. She will keep a pot in her head and her legs will be on a plate and with all mudras she will dance with four, according to the tune of the music she will dance, look at each and every person and she knows who will give her money. She will go near that person. All this affairs will be taking place, but with all that, her main attention is on that pot, not allowing it to fall. Punkhanu punkha vishayekshana tatvaropi brahmavaloka dhishanamna jahati yogi sangeeta tala laya nritya vashamgatapi maulistha kumbha parirakshana dhihi nativa. The dancing girl is nati, one who does natanam. And she, what does she do? Punkhanu punkha vishayekshana. Even minutest details around she observes. The jnani also observes, very observant. And he never leaves brahmavaloka dhishana. That awareness of Brahman, he never loses hold. Sangeeta tala laya nritya vashamgata. It is not that he keeps himself detached from the world. No. Only an aspirant needs detachment. The worldly man is attached. An aspiring person is detached. Jnani is neither attached nor detached. He finds himself one with everything. Nobody can be more involved than him. He is completely involved, one with everything. So, Vashangata, he says, he dances to all the tunes of life. He never wants to escape from anything. He is not bothered of escaping. So vasham gatahapi na jahati. He never leaves the hold of his inner refulgence. Established in that light, he moves about in the world. Navar, that is what Bhagavan says, uruti. Navar, leaving that, having a slip from that state is uruti. So here Bhagavan says, Arunachala, urudiya irupai. He says, Arunachala, be well established in my awareness. Shine forth in my awareness without any kind of covering, any kind of veiling. So, that is the prayer which Bhagavan has given us. See, when we do self-inquiry, atma-vichara at a certain state, the heart will reveal this prayer. It is not that you have to read it from somewhere. From the depth the prayer will arise, let not this state leave me. Let not I leave the hold of the self and catch hold of the body or mind or the worldly things. So that prayer is the thirst of the self. And the entire Aksharamanamalai is an expression of the thirst of the inner being. So let us continue the next verse and temporarily we will finish it tomorrow. Tomorrow we will have the last day of this session, this series. Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva. Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala. Yato mamatma bhavasitvameva, tato navachyam mamakinjitasti, yathata veshtam gurumam tathaiva, tvam atmanatham ramanam bhajami. Haranamah parvati pataye, haranamahadeva.